The following TGC production may not be rebroadcast or otherwise used without the expressed written consent of the Government Channel 16 and the City of Athens. Your local source for live meetings. The Government Channel presents...
This is Spotlight, 1997.
Welcome to Spotlight. On Spotlight, we'll be covering the ongoings of the Athens city government. We'll be behind the scenes at the police department, fire department, and public works, to name a few. Each show will highlight a different location within the city. Today, we're focusing on the city building located at 8 East Washington. Here, you can pay a water bill, attend a city council meeting, get a building permit, and even visit the mayor. Now, when you do visit the city building, make sure you park across the street in the city parking garage. It costs 60 cents an hour when there's a parking attendant on duty, or if you're leaving after 7 p.m. or on a Sunday, it's a flat $2. Now, the city building hasn't always been home to just city government offices. The Government Channel's Elisa Rich has more.
The cornerstone for the present Athens City Building was laid in August of 1874, an occasion that prompted a mayor and council. The first floor at one time or another housed a barbershop, a community library, a well baby clinic, and the town post office, as well as the police and fire departments. Until 1923, the second floor served as an opera house, used for school commencements, plays, concerts, and speeches. In June of 1966, Athens secured its first fire station designed exclusively for the fire department and located on Columbus Road. During the previous decade, the fire department had occupied space in the city building. Today, the building houses city council, the mayor's office, and various other departments, including code and the city court system. I'm Elisa Rich for the Government Channel with another bicentennial moment.
Today, more than 50 people work in the city building. Now, much of Athens' history can be traced through its area cemeteries. The city oversees the maintenance of the West State Street Cemetery. The Government Channel's Sonia Cook gives us a closer look at a restoration project that's going on there.
The West State Street Cemetery restoration project was initiated by former Mayor Sarah Hendricker. For several years now, however, it has been run by Terry Gilkey of the Athens Public Works Department. Gilkey began the project by contacting the Tolliver Works Company, who has much experience in the restoration of cemeteries. Since the beginning of the project, the company has reconstructed 28 stones, some of which have laid on the ground for up to 42 years. While the actual process of restoring a stone takes only a few hours, there is much planning and research involved. Throughout the project, Gilkey has been forced to spend hours assessing the condition of the graveyard. This process has been hampered by lost records, missing headstones, and unmarked graves. The cemetery project is expected to last several years, but Gilkey is pleased with the progress of the workers thus far.
Some of Athens' leading citizens who attended the city building dedication ceremony in 1874 are buried in the West State Street Cemetery. Coming up next, my one-on-one interview with Athens City Mayor Rick Abel.
Thank you. 20 kids. For 1 hour a week, you leave your concrete world of flip phones and faxes and talk to 20 kids about how business works. They will question everything, but those 20 kids will talk to 20 more. So by Saturday, what you said on Thursday could be halfway around their world. You get to make a difference. Could just make the rest of your week pretty dull. That's the new JA, teaching kids how business works.
Every year, Americans throw away 25 billion polystyrene cups.
$1 out of every $10 we spend on food pays for packaging.
Less than 1% of the plastic we use is recycled.
Every year, we throw out enough office and writing paper to build a wall 12 feet high stretching from Los Angeles to New York City.
Buy stuff that's recycled. Recycle the stuff you buy. Take it back.
Since the city building's dedication in 1874, it's undergone several renovations. One of those renovations in the mid-80s built this walkway between the city building and the law administration building. In the law administration building, you can find the city auditor, city law offices, and the police department. For the second year in a row, Rick Abel has been voted the city's top official. I recently sat down with the mayor and we talked about his first year in office.
With his five-year-old son, Jason, and his wife, Mary, a former state representative at his side, Rick Abel is learning to balance his personal life with his professional and very public life as the mayor of the city of Athens. Abel served 10 years on city council before taking on his life's latest challenge.
Okay, now you've just completed your first year in office. How was the adjustment for your new administration?
It took a while to get organized and get going. I think that whenever you start a new administration, the employees have to kind of get used to you and your management style and what those goals are and how that all fits in and dovetails together. So we got that accomplished. One of the other things are, you know, some of them are just things that occurred during that time period, because like the school system had their primetime program in essence go bankrupt, and they closed it down. And then all of a sudden there were a lot of parents in the community concerned about, well, where will my child be after school until I can get home from work? So we instituted our after school program. We can handle up to 50 children. Got that put together within a, you know, maybe a 2 month period of time, and sold it out, and have a waiting list. But it also prepares the recreation department to become more of a community services department, because as the new recreation center and community center becomes more of a reality, how are we going to fit those types of programs and activities in so that the community center really gets used by everybody and not just for sporting activities or events? In the fire department, we tried to do two things. One was get initiated the planned purchase of a new pumper truck to complete the cycle of new equipment in that department, and that's under order and will be delivered probably in April. The other thing that we wanted to do was to schedule an assessment of the fire department, and so we hired outside consultants who have done numerous assessments of cities, met with them on many different occasions, and are now awaiting that final report. And what this assessment really will kind of do is say, okay, how long does it take us to get to various areas of the city to provide fire protection? Are our stations, our equipment, our manpower, how do they fall into what would be the optimal level of fire protection services, and what would be other levels that would be acceptable? When I came into office, no two computers were linked together within the city of Athens, so people weren't communicating as effectively as we could with the networks that are now capable today. Now, we have every computer within the city building and a law administration building all linked together in one network where we can share email and share files and information, so that when you try to get in contact work-wise from one area to the other, you don't have to leave a phone message and hope they call you back and you're in. You just send them an email and it's there. The next step of that is to link in the other city departments. And we will be doing that, the engineers tell me, once Continental Cable gets their rebuild done one of the channels devoted to the city can be used for that type of data transmission. I think we then have to go to the next step above that later in the year and create a network that is into the internet. We already have and have developed this summer a web page. We've done that with the help of people from Surf Network at a high university and some student interns. It's a nice web page. We've got the city code on there, all the housing rentals, a lot of phone numbers and everything. But that's one that we'll be getting a lot of work and attention to this year to get that in better. But I would like to be able to get our own identity as AthensOhioGovernment.com, and that is a function of spending some money, maybe $500 or $600 a month to lease the proper lines and everything, but it would make the city accessible, because as you sit in your living room and notice that pothole for the umpteenth time and know the city offices are closed, if you do have a computer, you know you can go to there, go to the city's webpage, send them a note, email about it, and it's done. Because then you have a record, we have a record of receiving that complaint and get it into a work orders process system and go. So a lot of things have been building blocks this year. There have been some successes in respect of, I would say, the after-school program. We haven't even talked about the parking at the fairgrounds. This is underutilized, but at least is there and has taken some streets, or taken some cars off our city streets. We're going to be trying to refine and look at the 24-hour parking rules and say, okay, once we've had them in effect for close to 6 months now, where are our problem areas? Where do we need to go from here? We'll be working with City Council on that in the coming year.
How has your experience on City Council helped you become a better mayor?
Well, there are two entirely different things in respect that as a legislator, your job is to work on ordinances and legislation and policy of overall the city and the and decisions on the allocation of the financial reference and resources of the city. As mayor, you're responsible for all of it. You can't vote on any of this legislation. You cannot make a decision on, I want to go spend $100,000 on such and such, or even $10,000 on something and do it. You have to have the permission and approvals of City Council. So you're on not the opposite side of the fence, but you're in a totally different administrative role. But having worked with three mayors during my tenure on council, I had a pretty, an idea of what was, happening. I learned a lot in this past year. Mm-hmm. I've also, reaffirmed my knowledge that government is slow, slow, slow. It's hard to get things done, but it's designed that way. We have three readings. We have 30 days after implementation so that, we don't rush into things. It's a slow animal. So that if I had the idea today to, do something, it might be 8 weeks before I could get it approved by council. Then I have to get it implemented. So that's one of the things that's sort of maybe the frustrations of the job at times is that it's slow.
Now, talking about adjustments, 1996 was an adjustment for your family as well. How does your life now as the mayor affect your family, your wife Mary, and your son Jason?
It's been effective in a little bit because I think, especially with Jason, the children and everybody, City Council is one thing, and President of Council, me and the mayor is another. I went down last spring to his preschool because they were having the Week of the Child. And one of the things they wanted to do was lunch with the mayor, and there's your 4 and 5 year olds. And they asked them, what does the mayor do? Not as a group, but individually, teacher, they've called them aside. They have some interesting answers. It's hanging up there in my office wall. One of them says, I think it was Cece, said, he's the owner of Athens. And Ross said, he picks flowers for moths. I don't quite understand that one. Deanna said, they work on buildings. So, there's a whole lot of concept here, and I like going out to the school systems to do that and bring an idea that government is there. Before we met today, I was at Morrison Elementary swearing in the new president of student council, and after Jeff Dill and I had a very various swearing-ins that we had to do. We had about 15 minutes of question and answers from fourth through sixth grade. And it got interesting. So Jason is impacted because, you know, pictures in the paper, there's a lot of that. So that's something that we have to deal with. But, I mean, it's something that we have been, since Mary, having spent his first 5 years as a state representative, I mean, he's used to reading about mom in the paper, too. Mm-hmm. So I always was, called out to meetings, or Mary was, at various times. I've got my own little rule. I don't want to go out 3 nights in a row. I've missed some things because of that, but the home time is important to me, and the weekends are especially important. But don't want to miss him growing up.
Mayor Abel's looking forward to challenges coming up in 1997. Look for a Spotlight special report featuring more of my interview with the mayor. When we return, it isn't easy growing up, but kids in Athens are getting some extra help from the Athens Police Department.
Test, not just of strength, but of the power of the mind. And if you complete the journey, you will be changed forever. The few, the proud, the Marines.
Picasso painted The Old Guitarist during a period of depression that lasted 4 years. His blue period. Today, with new discoveries, 80% of depressive disorders are being successfully treated, giving hope to millions that maybe now nobody has to have a blue period.
Statistics show that the average person over a lifetime has 75,302 dreams, 3.8 surprise parties, 563 pairs of socks, and 8.6 different jobs. Is educated by 39.7 teachers, laughs 1.5 million times, finds $8.15 in the sofa, tries 12 different hairstyles, plays 6.4 sports, and owns 3.5 pets. But the average person only has one life, so why mess it up with drugs? A message of 29.3 seconds from a drug-free Navy and Marine Corps.
On the third floor of the city building, you'll find the city's code enforcement office and the chambers where the city council meets. Regular meetings for the council are on the first and third Mondays of the month, beginning at 7:30. If you're unable to attend the meetings, you can watch them right here on the Government Channel 16 live. Now, an ongoing spotlight feature will focus on the Athens Police Department's DARE program. Today, we'll meet Officer Rick Crossan, who's in charge of the program, and learn more about DARE.
My name is Officer Rick Crossan. I'm with the Athens Police Department. And currently my position with the Athens Police Department is Crime Prevention Officer, as well as the DARE Officer, which is the Drug Abuse Resistance Education Program. The DARE program itself is a cooperative learning program, and it's through the cooperation of the schools and the education department, as well as the police departments, to come into the school to teach this program. Real quick, let you guys know about DARE. You know, DARE, if it wasn't for teachers like Mr. Stubbe, Mrs. Boger, principals like Mr. Reed, and also the superintendent like Mr. Martin, I wouldn't be in here. You know, I come in here and take time out of their class to talk to you kids and to talk to you guys, you know, about drugs and to perform the DARE program. And during the next, well, about 15 or 16 weeks, I'm going to be coming in here every Tuesday at this time, spending about 40 minutes with you, 45 minutes, however long we've got, and we're going to go through the program, and we're going to have a lot of fun. When I walk in the very first day of the DARE class, I walk in, I introduce myself, I get to know the kids, say hi to them, and give them their workbook the very first day.
Hi.
Hey.
I'm Ed Stubbe.
Officer Rick.
Glad to meet
you. Nice to meet you.
And nice, firm hand grip. You don't want to give them that limpy fish.
That's right, yeah. Grip. Yeah, don't like, you know, come on, guys, you know, be a bit man, you know. Shake that hand out there. Women, be a woman, you know.
You're not.
Well, I'll be a lady, you know.
Say your name.
Yeah, don't shy away, don't look at, don't just put a high, you know. You know, put that thing out there. Let me know who you are. But anyhow, just to introduce you real quick here to my friend, this is Darren. Darren's the DARE mascot. And yeah, I mean, it looks kind of funny that I'm walking around here and I get all kinds of weird looks from fellow police officers and people that are the public and all. They'll look at me kind of funny, like, you're carrying a stuffed animal, you know. But that's okay. Because Darren, he goes everywhere I go and I do DARE. And in class, what I'll do is I'll give him to you guys, let you guys take care of him, hold him and talk to him and say hi and everything. The only thing is, don't pull his tail, don't throw him, don't hit him and things, because he doesn't like that. Now, Darren gets mad at me every now and then because I do forget him every now and then at the office. And when I go back, he gets mad and he lets me know about it. So if you guys do anything wrong with him, he'll let you know about it. So I'm going to pass him around, take care of him, treat him with respect. And at lunch and at recess, you guys will get to take care of him, babysit him for me. So when y'all see me come in at lunchtime, let me know and I'll pass him off to you. And guys, don't be afraid to hold him, talk to him and things, because I know guys are like, hey man, I can't do this, man. You know, this ain't cool. This ain't cool. But it is cool. It's, you know, have fun with him. I walk around with him. I'm an adult. You know, since I've been a DARE officer, probably the things I like the most about it is getting to know the kids. Someone made the statement, kids, you gotta love them. And to me, that's what being a DARE officer is all about. You gotta love them. The kids today, they grew up in a society that is just totally rocked with, you know, with violence and drugs. And fortunately, around Athens, it's not as near as bad as maybe an inner city or a bigger city, but the problems are still here. And being able to come into the school and to get to know these kids and to talk to them, and for them to get to know me. When I leave the classroom after being in there with them so many weeks, they don't even realize I'm a police officer anymore. And to me, that is very important, that they grow to look at me as a friend. What this box is for is, if you have a question that you want to ask about drugs, you know, about me, or just a comment you want to make, or whatever, we'll stick it in this box here. And what I'll do is, when I come into the classroom each time, I'll pick some questions out of it, and we'll answer some questions that are in the box. I enjoy visiting with them, and what happens to them means a lot to me. As the time goes, I want you guys to realize that, yeah, I am a police officer, okay? But I'm also here as a friend of yours. You know, I'm here to help you guys if there's something you need help with. I had a little boy tell me once, about low self-esteem, and he got to use the marijuana. And the little boy, when he came up to talk to me about it, it was something that I'll never forget. You know, we dealt with it, and you know, to this day, I can hope to say that he's on the way to staying away from drugs. This is Officer Rick Crossan with your DARE update for Spotlight.
That's all for today's Spotlight. Join me again next time when Spotlight goes to the Athens County Courthouse and the Board of Elections. We'll learn more about the city's primary elections taking place this spring and the candidates who are running for office. At the City Building for Spotlight, I'm Shereen Jones. Thanks for watching.
For everyone at Spotlight, I'm Dennis Cometti. Good night.
From the AFRTS News Center in Washington, this is the 2-Minute Report. I'm Army Sergeant John Susner. On this edition, new recruits.
Hi, Dan Johns.
These men and women are about to begin careers in the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps. Many of them are among the more than 180,000 first-time recruits who signed up for active duty during fiscal year 1996. 96% of these applicants taking their first steps into the military are high school graduates, and 7 out of 10 scored above average on military entrance tests. The Pentagon's force management chief says attracting quality recruits is critical because today's military does more than train for combat.
We also call on our people to participate in peacekeeping and humanitarian type operations in which people have to show a great deal of restraint and individual judgment in dealing with situations. You need quality people to do that.
Officials say they're delighted the new recruits represent so many ethnic and cultural groups.
Well, our principle is that the forces that we have that are committed to defend America ought to look like America.
Pick that form up and put it on your clip.
Of this year's recruits, 68% are white, 19% are black, 9% are Hispanic, and 17% are female. Mr. Pang says that means no one group gets more of the benefits or burdens of carrying out America's defense.
We want, you know, all of our people to have the opportunity to serve their country. And then they're called upon to make sacrifices for the country, that the sacrifices are equally shared.
Mr. Pang says the newest recruits bode well for today's military and for tomorrow's, too. That's the 2-Minute Report. From Washington, I'm Army Sergeant John Susner.